Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 28th meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2022. Before we begin, can I remind all those members using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Our first item of business today is a decision on taking item 4 in private. Are we agreed? Thank you. Our second item of business this morning is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands on common frameworks. And I welcome to the meeting Mary Goujon, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands, George Burgess, Director of Agriculture and Rural Economy, and Ewan Page, Head of UK Frameworks in the Scottish Government. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Well, thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, everyone. And thank you for inviting me today to come and give evidence on common frameworks. We are coming to the culmination of a process which actually started all the way back in October 2017 with the agreement of the framework principles by the Joint Ministerial Committee on European Negotiations. And I know that there have been concerns about the delays during the development of these frameworks, and I share the frustration of both the Parliament and indeed of stakeholders at the time it's taking to finalise and deliver them. But the most significant factors in causing these delays lie outside the Scottish Government's control, and I'm of course grateful for the committee's patience on this. But despite these frustrations, we remain committed to working collaboratively with the UK Government on common frameworks on the basis of consensus and in line with the framework principles. Now, these frameworks, including the ones currently being scrutinised by the committee, are being established to manage policy divergence on the basis of agreement and in a way that respects devolution. They've been operational on an interim basis since the end of the transition period, and they will, of course, remain provisional until all four UK legislators have completed their parliamentary scrutiny. And I think it's important to note at this point that these frameworks are policy neutral. They are intergovernmental arrangements for managing policy divergence and aren't in themselves policy innovations. The fundamental reason for putting these frameworks in place hasn't changed. When we were taken out of the EU after the 2016 referendum, we accepted that there would be some areas where the practical, regulatory and market implications of that decision would need to be managed. And the frameworks offer a model by which to manage such implications by agreement and collaboration between equals rather than by imposition. And this could be usefully applied to intergovernmental relations in the UK more widely, but sadly this is not something that is much in evidence in other UK government efforts. The UK Government Internal Market Act is a glaring example of the UK's the government's willingness to drive a coach and horses through the devolution settlement when it suits them, and it's legislation that we remain fundamentally opposed to. It continues to pose a significant threat to the implementation of the common frameworks, and I'm sure that's something that we'll pick up later on in this session. And several of the frameworks which were published earlier this year fall under this committee's remit. And as I've said in previous sessions with the committee, I am committed to being open and transparent in relation to this and to working with you as much as possible during the scrutiny process for these frameworks.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. As you say, these are provisionally in operation, but in practice, they're probably going to be a moving feast. They're never going to come to an end where we have a final piece of legislation. But since January 2021, they have been in operation to some extent. So can you give us some examples of how they work in operation and what have been the successes and challenges since they come into operation?
Yeah, I think certainly in this area in particular, the common frameworks that we have set out essentially replicate mechanisms that have been in place already. So while we are working through these and trying to work through the common frameworks on an interim basis until they are agreed and they've been through that scrutiny process, again, they build on those existing mechanisms and the terms of engagement and ways that we've engaged with the UK government previously. So I don't think that it's an entirely new process for us. I mean, when you look to the EFRA area in particular and the way that we've worked with the UK government, we've had the interministerial group in place for some time. We've talked through some of these issues. So I think, in a sense, what the common frameworks do is they formalise some of those existing structures that have already been in place.
So what lessons have you learnt? So can you give us some examples within your remit of how they've changed and what lessons have you learnt as you've gone through this process?
I think it's fair to say that we're probably still learning the lessons, and the frameworks would still need to be embedded. I think there have been some examples, particularly when you look at the exclusions process that we have in the UK Internal Market Act. I don't know if that's something that we'll be covering later on in the session, but we've used that once so far. We have one example of that in relation to single-use plastics, where that process has been used through the common frameworks. But we've also seen examples where, despite all four administrations agreeing to this process and agreeing to work in collaboration, where they haven't been adhered to. And an example of that would be the Precision Breeding Bill, which the UK government has introduced, which should have used this process, but instead started the other way around. So the bill was published without having had that discussion with the other administrations within the UK. So I think it's important that, I think with some of these areas, that we learn the lessons as we work through this process as to how we should be engaging with each other. But again, we're very much still working our way through that.
Okay, thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, convener. Obviously, this whole category of government activity around these frameworks is forced upon us all by the existence of Brexit, which is another story. But I just wonder, are there elements of the frameworks, the working groups and so on, are all of those elements operational now, or there are still bits of it that have still to be created?
Yes, well, I'll probably ask George to come in more detail and can probably provide a further example as to how that's operating at the moment in comparison to how things would have worked before, if that would be helpful.
Okay, thanks. Yes, I mean, essentially the frameworks are operational, so all the groups that are described in them are up and running. For example, as the Cabinet Secretary said, we have, in the DEFRA space, we have the Interministerial Group. Below that, we have a number of structures, a senior officials programme board. We have policy collaboration groups. One of the things that, as the Cabinet Secretary most of that was already in place for some time. One of the bits that actually had to be created specifically because of Brexit was the market monitoring group. So a function previously carried out by the European Commission, we had to create a domestic version of that. So that work is up and running. That group is meeting, and its material is being published on the UK government website for all to see.
And can I just ask on the back of that, can you explain a bit more about what the market monitoring group does and how it's coming to be?
Right. So that is essentially looking at the principal agricultural commodities, so beef, sheep, grain, pig meat, dairy, looking at prices on the market, looking at trends. As I say, that was a function previously carried out by the European Commission to guide whether they needed to intervene in the markets in any way through private storage aid or the like. We no longer have access to that European consideration, so this group provides that function on a sort of UK-wide basis, so that if they identify problems in the market, and obviously in the last 18 months, 2 years, we've had a number of examples of that, they can then provide that analytical advice to the other groups in the structure, ultimately to ministers, so that ministers in the various administrations can decide whether they need to take action to intervene.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, convener. I'm just going to refer back to the question that the convener asked and the challenges of the frameworks, given that they appear to be agreed between governments. But stakeholder evidence gives the view that provisions of the UK Internal Market Act render them kind of useless. And I'll note the Law Society of Scotland said that we note there are no domestic legal constraints on the powers of the UK Parliament or the UK Government concerning common frameworks. Conversely, we note that devolved governments will be bound by such common frameworks either because they've agreed them or because they are bound by law. Does that give you concern about how the common frameworks will work for the Scottish Government?
Well, it does give us serious concern, because I think as much as we've committed to this process and we believe that this is actually a really good model that we've put forward in terms of how we can work together and how we can manage policy divergence, I think we all recognise the need for common frameworks. We've committed to that process, but then we have seen a series of acts come forward which have sought to undermine that. And I think that that was also clear in the evidence and the report from the House of Lords Committee and their scrutiny of this as well in relation to the UK Internal Market Act, which really undermines the work that we've tried to achieve through the Common Frameworks process. We also have the Subsidy Control Act as well, which again constrains the work that we've committed to taking forward through the Common Frameworks. We also have the retained EU Law Bill, which is currently progressing through the UK Parliament too, which causes us serious concern. And as much as we've been told that the Common Frameworks will be protected in that, as yet we haven't been told how that's going to happen. So I think it is really frustrating and really concerning that as much as we've committed to this process and we do think it's a positive way to collaborate and move forward, that it's continually undermined by these other pieces of legislation which seek to hamper the choices that we can take.
Yeah, my understanding is that despite all of the rhetoric around how this will be a common framework, we'll work together, ultimately it's the UK Minister who will have the overruling decision on whether or not a common framework is within exemptions that the Scottish Government may wish to apply. Is that correct? Is that your understanding?
Ultimately, I think the backstop of all these positions is that's where we end up, unfortunately. But I do think it's important that we have that exclusions process in place in relation to the UK Internal Market Act. I'd given a bit of an example earlier as to how we've been able to use that. But again, that process hasn't been without its issues as well in relation to that directive. So, for example, when we introduced those regulations to the Scottish Parliament, there was a gap there in the implementation in terms of the items that we would have wished to see banned. I think the initial exclusion was that the UK Government were putting forward, it was more narrow than what we would have sought from a Scottish Government perspective, and the UK regulations didn't come into force until late August. So we had a few months where there was that gap in implementation. So again, as much as it's important and we have the mechanisms where we can try to exclude that, and again, it's not perfect.
Okay, so we can only hope that we manage to get agreed points as we go forward. Thank you, Convener.
Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. So, given that there's work being done in Scotland, so this is a question about funding capacity, resource for this additional work. We've got the, we've got what you in your directorate need to do in terms of policy in Scotland. Then we've got the UK, the Continuity Act that we're tracking what's going on in the EU, and now we've got this common framework, so the need to track the relationship between the four devolved nations. And I just wonder if there's kind of agreed resource and funding that makes it possible for you to do that work well, or are we having to kind of like stretch between departments and move people around? It just seems like it's another layer of work that's having to take place, and is there the funding for that?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if officials would want to come in on that point in particular, but I suppose it comes back to what we were saying earlier. In some ways, this builds on existing structures that we had already, but I'm sure that George or Ian would be able to say more in terms of what that means for their own personal workloads in relation to that. But I think it's positive on the whole in the way that we can collaborate together in relation to that.
Yes, I mean, taking your specific point about, continuity and alignment with EU law, obviously that's a Scottish Government position. It's not one that is shared by our colleagues in DEFRA, so while I'm sure that they will have some eye to developments in Brussels, they're not attempting to track it as closely as we would, so that's probably not an area where we can rely on a sort of collaborative approach there to share the resources and do the job once for all administrations. In other places, I mentioned earlier the Market Monitoring Group, actually a lot of the work there is done by DEFRA, and we benefit from the work of their greater analytical capacity. But when it comes to keeping an eye on EU developments, that's probably something that we have to do more of for ourselves.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning. We've spoken about the challenges and the concerns, but how will the four administrations ensure transparency about the actual operation of the common frameworks? And second part of the question is about the working group meetings, and I was actually surprised when I saw the paper just how many there actually are. How do you, within the working group meetings within each of the frameworks, how is information made available to Parliament and the public?
Well, at the moment, taking your first point about the transparency of the process, I know that that was a concern that was highlighted by those that have provided evidence to the committee in relation to that. And I understand and recognise the stakeholder concerns in relation to that. And again, I think that's where we're actually keen to get the committee's feedback in terms of what that scrutiny process could be like going forward. I know that we have set out in the frameworks that we have at the moment in terms of how they would be monitored and reviewed, but that's where we want to hear from the committee scrutiny as to how we could, if there's ways that we can improve the relaying of information, make that process more transparent, then happy to consider any suggestions that come forward as a result of that. In terms of some of the reporting mechanisms that we have at the moment, I know that the committee will be aware that we publish the draft communiques from the interministerial group meetings that we have. We also provide an update after those meetings take place as to some of the areas that we've been working on or have been looking to discuss. But again, more than happy to take any particular comments or suggestions once the committee's finished its scrutiny of this.
Okay.
Jenny Mintel.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for coming along. You said in your introduction it should be a collaboration amongst equals. So following on from Beatrice Wishart's question, how is that... Does it feel like a collaboration between equals, between how the devolved parliaments are working with Westminster?
In relation to the development of the common frameworks, yes. I would come back to, I think it has been a really positive piece of work. I know that I'll be coming back to the committee in relation to the joint fisheries statement as an example of that, where I think that's shown that when we do work together, we can work together well. Again, it is just frustrating when I think of some of the examples I mentioned earlier where we see that process being undermined or where it hasn't been quite adhered to. But I think if all four governments are committed to that process and we are adhering to it, then I think it does offer a really positive model of cooperation and how that could be used more widely across other different areas. And I think it sets a good example of collaboration between the different governments.
And if I may, we're taking evidence from you with regards to this. Interested to know, you made the point about we could feedback to you about thoughts that we have as a result of this. Is that discussed? Is further stakeholder and parliamentary engagement, is that talked about at your meetings?
Well, it hasn't been yet because I know that all the different parliaments have obviously been undertaking their own scrutiny processes. But I think once we've been through all of that and that scrutiny process is complete, then we would be looking to engage to see what changes would be needed to the frameworks process. Because I think the scrutiny that you've undertaken and the evidence that you've taken as well has been really important for us to see in areas within the frameworks that I think could be improved on the back of that. And I also know that stakeholder engagement came out really strongly, I think, in all the evidence and in relation to the House of Lords report that I mentioned earlier too, as to how we could better engage. I think some of the points in the stakeholder engagement, though, I think I recognise the concerns that have been raised in relation to that. But I do also think we need to strike a fine balance there because we also need to have that space, I think, between the different governments for that free and frank discussion that we need. And it's also important to highlight that the common frameworks process that we have, it doesn't replace the stakeholder engagement we currently undertake in policy development, and it's not intended to replace that process. We would still be engaging with stakeholders in the normal way, as we normally do, when we are, whether that's bringing forward legislative proposals or looking at policy development. So I think I really would just want to emphasise that point, that we're not replacing that. That is still a vital part of how we develop policy. But this is another mechanism that sits alongside that.
Okay, thank you.
Just before we move on, anybody tuning in to the first few minutes of this would have got the impression this was all a bit of a disaster and Westminster were ignoring the Scottish Government. It wasn't really working. It sounded pretty grim. And subsequent questions suggested that some of the policies that the Scottish Government might be undermined. But then 10 minutes later, you were saying it was all very positive. So can you confirm whether the operation of the common frameworks within the four administrations is working well and does what it says in the tin?
Well, that's the thing. I wouldn't agree in that I don't think I've contradicted myself, because I think it is a really strong model. And again, if all administrations, as we've committed to, adhere to the process that we've set out, I think it could work well. But I think the problem is we have seen that process undermined. So again, I talked through the example of the exclusions process. That was the first time we'd used it. It didn't work perfectly, so hopefully lessons will be learnt from that as we move forward from here. But if we all adhere to it, then I think it is a positive process and it's a good model. But that's the point. We need that to be adhered to. And we also can't have that undermined by pieces of legislation brought forward, which that's exactly what it's set out to do. It constrains the policy choices that we can make, which is the complete opposite of what we all committed to through the Common Frameworks process.
Yeah, which I presume is it also deals with a position that the Scottish Government want to align with EU law, which is contrary to what some of the other administration's positions are. So the framework's there to deal with that.
Yeah, to be able to manage that policy divergence where that takes place.
Okay, thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much, Convener. You mentioned the four-country approach there. I mean, I think I would slightly differ with the Convener's take on some of that, and I think it's presumably up to this Parliament to align if it chooses to align. But leave that be. Can I ask you to explain a bit more about, in practical terms, how the four-country approach works and how much room it leaves for such divergence, given it is this Parliament's choice whether it wishes to diverge or not?
Absolutely. Well, that's the thing. I don't know if it'll be helpful for George to again outline or see if there's particular examples that we can talk through and how we've managed that. I mean, I talk about the Precision Breeding Bill as one example where, unfortunately, the Common Frameworks process was bypassed, but we are now working through that there, because there could be divergence in relation to that. There could be an impact on us in Scotland, which we have to try and manage. So, but I'll hand over to George, who'll be able to provide a bit more of the detail.
Okay, I think maybe the most useful bit of background is actually going right back to the start of this process, and as the Cabinet Secretary mentioned, the set of principles that were agreed in the sort of joint ministerial committee back in 2017. And one of those ones, the key one, is to enable the functioning of the UK internal market while acknowledging policy divergence. So quite fundamental to all the frameworks is the recognition that, you know, policy divergence can and will happen, and the whole purpose of the framework is to make sure that we do that in as collaborative a fashion as we can do.
And can I ask a little a bit about how you've engaged with stakeholders on some of these issues? I was interested to hear you use the phrase "coach and horses." Of course, those of us who are on another committee, the Constitution Committee in the Parliament, SEAC, I've heard that phrase used to us by NFUS, where they've described we've had the internal market act, which, as I said, almost drives a coach and horses through the principles of common frameworks. So do you feel that you mentioned it as a backstop, but do you feel the existence of other legislation like that provides a direct threat to what you're trying to achieve through the common frameworks?
Absolutely, because I think as much as we have an exclusions process, I think that threat still remains. And I think the Subsidy Control Act is another example of that, where I think that all the concerns that we raised throughout that process, and that particularly in relation to agriculture, which we felt should not have been part of that regime in the first place, have just been completely ignored. And I know that that's another specific example that's been used. So again, that's what's really frustrating and really worrying, is that we, as much as we commit to this process, there are these pieces of legislation which are a real threat to not just that process, but to devolution.
And finally, can I understand that the Law Society have also raised some of these issues in their words, I think, noting that there are no domestic legal constraints on the powers of the UK Parliament or the UK Government concerning common frameworks. And I wonder, because of obviously the sovereign nature of the UK Parliament and the backstop which they present in all these matters, I just wonder what conversations you've had with the UK government about how they intend to use those powers.
Yes, I mean, I'll be happy to pass to you, and he'll be able to provide more information on that.
I suppose what I'm driving at is, do they, presumably we've mentioned two particular acts of the UK Parliament, do you have concerns that they could use it in other ways too?
Yes, I would have concerns about that, but sorry.
I think the key point to remember is that frameworks are non-legislative arrangements. They're not binding on any party. And as the Cabinet Secretary has set out, they offer, that is in a way their strength, that they offer an alternative model of progress on managing the practical implications of managing regulatory coherence in a multi-level state by agreement rather than imposition. We do, however, operate in the unique circumstances of the UK Constitution, and Parliament remains sovereign. And we have seen worrying developments since Brexit about repeated breaches of the Seoul Convention with respect to legislation passing without the consent of the devolved administrations. The Cabinet Secretary has alluded to the retained EU law agenda and the concerns there, and certainly the Internal Market Act was an unwelcome and unanticipated intrusion in the development of common frameworks, and was, of course, itself implemented without the consent of this Parliament. So we're under no illusions about the challenges we face and the specifics of the UK's constitutional arrangements, but common frameworks do offer the best existing model for an alternative way of managing these practical day-to-day challenges of managing regulatory coherence in a devolved state like the United Kingdom.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Just before we move on, you know, stakeholders have highlighted that frameworks can pursue a different approach, but you know, it also allows for different approaches where the four nations diverge. But they're still vital. Given that the four-country approach to regulation and decision-making, can you give us examples, or are there areas where the framework actually will create a closer collaboration between the four nations than previously existed?
I'll be happy to come back to the committee if I can think of specific examples in relation to that. I think because it's, as I've said in some of the previous responses that I've given, they build on existing models that we've had where we do have strong collaboration. I think the animal health and welfare that you've seen and the framework that we've put forward there, I think, sets that out as well. There are a number of groups where we work together because, of course, when it comes to animal health, diseases don't respect borders, so it's important that we work together and we have that cross collaboration. But if there are further examples of that, I'd be happy to follow that up with committee, or unless George has more at the moment.
Just a small example. As Cabinet Secretary said, a lot of that collaboration was already existing. One very specific bit that was introduced as a result of the agricultural support framework is a group specifically looking at cross-border holdings. Now, obviously, you know, as part of the EU, we would have been looking within the UK at any effects between the different jurisdictions, but we've given a specific focus to that by establishing a group. In practical terms, that's a bigger issue between Wales and England because of, you know, the nature of our landscape, but it is of some relevance for Scotland as well, and we're part of that group. So there's one example where, as a result of the frameworks, there is actually a greater focus and a greater collaboration than hitherto.
Thank you. Jenny.
Thank you, Convener. Looking back to 2016, supporters of Brexit said it was about taking back control. However, I might argue that we can see that actually they meant Westminster taking back control from Scotland. I too sit on the SEAC committee, and we took evidence from a variety of people, and one was Professor McEwen and colleagues, who suggested that frameworks could commit the Scottish Government to share or minimal standards and rules, potentially limiting the scope for action of the Scottish Parliament. I'd just like to ask what areas you think we could be impacted with our devolved settlement.
Yes, I think Ewan would like to come in on that question.
I think we've worked closely with Professor McEwen and many of our colleagues over the last years on these issues, and I think I'd probably disagree with the risk to frameworks imposing a constraint in devolved policy making. That's not what they're there to do. They're not in themselves instruments for policy innovation. They're mechanisms for managing the changed circumstances we find ourselves in now that we're no longer an EU member state. And George alluded earlier to the JMCN principles that underpin frameworks and have proved remarkably resilient and useful as a touchstone in understanding how frameworks operate. And the frameworks and the principles are very clear that they are there. Frameworks should operate in a way that respects the democratic accountability of the devolved institutions and the devolution settlements. So it's hard to think of an example where we would be in a position where, through the frameworks process, you are seeking to impose a self-imposed constraint on devolved policy options as a result. That's not what frameworks are there to do. They're there to anticipate, notify and manage potential issues around intra-UK regulated adherence at the earliest possible opportunity. So that kind of scenario should never arise.
OK, thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
Just on that point, I wanted to ask whether the common frameworks have led to an increase in the devolved nations' decision-making powers.
They wouldn't have... Well, we've had more powers in relation to our decision-making as a result of what's flown through now from leaving the EU. But again, this isn't... The common frameworks in and of themselves don't give us more powers. They're there to set out a way of collaboration and working with each other in terms of how we manage that policy divergence, if that makes sense and answers your question. Sorry, Ewan.
The Cabinet Secretary is absolutely right. This is frameworks have not conferred new powers or additional decision-making capacity to the devolved institutions. They are a recognition, they're a mechanism for managing the change dispensation we're in, whereas previously we would exercise devolved powers, and including UK Government acting for England, would exercise devolved powers within a symmetrically applied framework provided by EU membership. So it's the same powers being exercised in a different context, and frameworks offers a mechanism for managing the practical implications of that change context.
Can I just remind members that the session today with the Cabinet Secretary is to explore common frameworks within the remit of this committee, which is agriculture, and not more broadly on constitutional issues around common frameworks. And our questioning should be focused on that. Alistair.
We're talking about evidence from farmers.
Yeah, well, I think
we
do have a paper in front of us which focuses on the agricultural side of things. I just feel that we're concentrating a lot on the constitutional issues rather than specifically about the common frameworks and how they affect agriculture, specifically, as this committee is supposed to do. On that, can I ask that in relation to the animal health and welfare framework, The framework sets out a preference for joint policy making and that the whole of animal health and welfare policy is on the scope of that. But that's in contrast to other frameworks. So can I ask, why do some frameworks only include policy areas previously governed by EU law?
I think most other frameworks do that. I think the animal health and welfare a common framework is one area where it is more broad, and I think that's probably given the nature of the issues that we're dealing with. You know, as I'd highlighted in a previous response as well, animal health doesn't respect borders. We have a strong history of collaboration. I think you can see that from some of the decision-making forum that already exists that are listed within the framework as well and our ways of working. So I think it's really important, and I think it's actually a really positive development that we look at those policy areas in the round in terms of how we collaborate with each other.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, you've got your additional
I'll
question.
I'll then
as
go
well.
On to my next question anyway. In terms of the divergence between Scotland and other areas of the UK, I'm right in thinking right now there is an avian flu housing policy in England, but it's not in Scotland, because there's about 80 cases in England, but there's only four here in Scotland. And I would refer back to 2000 when we had foot and mouth. It was a Scottish decision that was taken to close immediately. We found a case in Scotland, whereas south of the border, they took a week to make that decision, and as such, there was a much bigger spread down south. Surely we would be wanting to retain our own ability to make decisions here in Scotland on animal health and welfare.
Oh, absolutely. And this wouldn't change that anyway. I mean, you've given that example there. And, you know, if you want further details as, in relation to that, then I'd be happy to write to the committee as to the decisions that we've taken in relation to that as well. But like I say, that wouldn't be impacted by the framework.
Okay, thank you.
Come in, Rachel's got a supplementary on that.
That has the, not the reverse happened this time, where England has had a lockdown in relation to avian flu for example, keeping kept birds inside, whereas Scotland hasn't this time.
But again, we
just
have,
for the record, is that not the reverse of what Jim just said that's happening this week?
But that highlights the point that I'm trying to make.
Yeah.
That we should have our own retained...
But we do.
Yeah. So I'm highlighting that fact.
And that's what I'm saying, we still have that ability in the common framework, don't change that.
I just think it is important in this committee, considering the significant concern that farmers have with avian flu right now, is that we put that on the record.
Oh, sorry, John.
Yeah, just to add, and I think the point related to the frameworks that is that we have daily, probably several times daily, contact between the chief veterinary officers of the different administrations, looking at the situation in the ground in each part of the UK, so that they can then advise ministers and the respective administrations of the appropriate course of action to take the avian influenza example. We've got a really acute situation, particularly in East Anglia, dreadful for the producers and not good for all the other stakeholders involved, including the Animal and Plant Health Agency. There is close interaction between the administrations, particularly at chief veterinary officer level.
Okay. Jim Fairley.
Without labouring the point, that was exactly the point that I was making. There's already close collaboration on those things. Therefore, we're still talking about what it is that's contained in the paper. What I would like to move on to, though, is the Scottish Government's degree of understanding of the policy divergence that will be accepted within the common frameworks and how that divergence will be assessed.
Well, I think that's why we have the common frameworks process, is really to assess and to discuss at a really early stage. And I know that that's part of what's set out in each of the common frameworks as well, is to ensure that we're sharing information early and that we try and resolve any potential issues as early as possible without needing that escalation. But it's to ensure that we discuss at an early stage if it looks like there may be a policy divergence, to then have those discussions as to what the impacts of that might be and how that could then potentially be managed.
Okay, so going back to 2016, I very clearly remember asking the head of the Tory party here in Scotland and David Mundell where the governance of what would happen in agriculture would lie post EU exit. And we were told that there would be far more power coming to Scotland. That was the repeated mantra, there would be far more power coming to Scotland. We have the decision-making policy right now on what the new agricultural support system will be. But given the Subsidy Control Bill, or the Subsidy Control Act as it now is, brought in by the UK government, do you have any concerns that what it is that we're trying to do here could fall foul of that act at a later point?
Those have been the concerns that we've reiterated right through the process of the passage of that bill and now Act. And it is really frustrating that none of those concerns were either addressed, or we didn't see that the Act amended in any way that in a way that would have resolved the concerns that we have. I know that officials are working together now on the guidance and what the practical implications of that are going to be. I understand that those conversations are ongoing, but I mean that's one of the biggest threats and concerns that we have that I've outlined to the committee previously.
So how do the common frameworks protect your ability to put that policy in place to ensure that the policies that we want to implement here in Scotland in terms of agricultural support will be what the Scottish Government intended to be? Yeah. How do the common frameworks protect that?
Well, we would be discussing at an early stage what our proposals are, how we'd be intending to bring that forward. I'm sure George can talk through more of the detail as to how that works its way through that process. But I think that's where I come back to the previous concerns that I have, that is a really positive and collaborative way of working. But at the same time, you have these pieces of legislation coming from the side which do seek to undermine that and which could constrain our policy choices. I think working on the guidance is really important to see what the practical implications of the Subsidy Control Act are going to be, because that's been our concern right throughout, that it would constrain the policy choices that we make here, because the direction that we might like to take could be completely hampered by that legislation and some of the principles that are within it. For example, when you look at, I mean, we have a very different landscape here. Some of the voluntary and coupled support schemes that we have don't exist in other parts of the UK. We have them for a very specific reason here, because we want to continue to support people that are farming in the most difficult terrain and the most remote and rural parts of the country. And we were concerned that the Subsidy Control Act would hamper our ability to do that, or that there could be disputes further down the line in relation to that. So, again, we'll continue to work through the process, and as I say, George will talk through how that practically works. But
let me come back in very quickly, George, before you bamboozle me with the science of it. The UK Government's policy has been very much geared towards, now I don't know if it's changed or not, because there has been quite a bit of turbulence over the last couple of weeks and I haven't been home. But my understanding is that the UK Government's position is that by 2027 all direct support will be taken away, and that the process down south will be entirely based around environmental controls and access to land, whereas the Scottish Government's preferred option is still to retain 50%, that's the quoted figure, whether that's correct or not, you can clarify, 50% of direct payments in order to continue to allow support for food production. Is that the kind of area that will cause concerns, and will common frameworks allow you to protect that position?
Well, that's where the common frameworks process allows us to try and address or to work through potential issues where that may emerge. But again, they won't in themselves necessarily protect that if you have another piece of legislation from the side which
so
completely undermines
it. So ultimately, the Subsidy Control Bill could overrule the common frameworks that you want to put forward, or the negotiating position that you put forward in the common frameworks. This is the policy we want to address. The UK Government have a completely different policy which diverges from yours, and therefore that piece of legislation could overrule the work of the common frameworks. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, because that's the legislation. And again, we don't have the common frameworks aren't a legislative mechanism, and they're a means that we've all agreed to work through as a means of collaboration and on the basis that we're collaborating with each other as equals. So again, that's where I come back to the concerns I've said that about the UK Internal Market Act and the Subsidy Control Bill, because they do undermine that process. And I think that's been recognised through the House of Lords and the work that they've done on this as well.
OK, George, bamboozle with us the science of how this is going to work.
OK, I think you're correct that the Subsidy Control Act and the Internal Market Act as legislation would take precedence over anything that is in the framework. The Internal Market Act, to be fair, does recognise that one of the reasons that UK ministers might seek to introduce exceptions to the market access principles is specifically because of something that might have been agreed through a common framework process. So it's not all one way, but yes, the legislation would take precedence over anything that's here. In terms of agricultural support, as the example that's been used, the mechanism set out in the framework would be essentially that discussions would take place principally in the policy collaboration group between the administrations. So we regularly see in that group administrations coming forward, setting out, you know, in broad terms, you know, the policies that they're intending to bring forward. That's an opportunity for each administration to say, oh, wait a minute, hold on. Great, you can do what you want in your administration, but that causes a problem for the internal market or for divergence. So that's the opportunity that we have within that group, and, you know, potentially for that to be, you know, escalated up ultimately to the interministerial group. And we've had at several of the recent interministerial groups, you know, quite good discussions. The last meeting was hosted by the Welsh Government, at which they were setting out the proposals that they had just launched a consultation on. So the frameworks essentially provide that opportunity for the administrations to explain to the others what they're doing, for other administrations to, you know, raise a red flag if there are any difficulties with what they see. We also have the World Trade Organization Agreement on Agriculture process, at the risk of bamboozling. So there's a formal mechanism that all administrations must provide advance notice of schemes of agricultural support, ultimately for notification to the World Trade Organization. So there are formal mechanisms there that we're all using.
Okay, I see you, Rachel, wants to get us up. So,
Rachel.
I just wondered how the common frameworks interact with the market principles of non-discrimination and mutual recognition, where, of course, a devolved government can take a different policy journey, shall we say.
I'll give a bit of the answer, and then I'll leave it to you and to bamboozle on this occasion. Yes, the market access principles set out in the Internal Market Act apply across the board. There are, in that Act, some exceptions for issues of, you know, food safety, for instance, that different decisions can be taken. But generally, they're across the board, and any departure from that would require the use of the exceptions process that's set out in the Act. We've talked earlier about the use of that so far in relation to single-use plastics. But that's the mechanism. If it's covered by the market access principles, basically, we have little choice unless one of the exceptions applies.
I think that's precisely the point. Useful here to contrast the principles of mutual recognition and non-discrimination, which are common to most internal market regimes and are at the centre of how the European single market operates. But in that, in the ESM, they operate as broad legal principles that can be applied. In the Internal Market Act, there are rigid statutory requirements, so there's much less flexibility to tailor policy in a way that recognises local needs and conditions. And as George has alluded to, there's much less by the way of derogations and exemptions set out in statute. It's a very small number of issues relating to crudely, things that might kill you if they weren't there, you know, animal plant health emergencies, chemicals and pesticides and so forth. The European single market, you have the principle of a kind of rolling recognition that member states can, while observing the broad legal principles of mutual recognition and non-discrimination, can make the case for legislation disregarding these in pursuit of wider environmental, social or economic goals, for example. So that's the kind of difference. It's a much less, the Internal Market Act is a much less flexible, much more rigid statutory regime. And that creates problems for tailoring local policy and ensuring that devolved legislation has its intended effect. And it's why it's such a difficult issue to manage in the context of developing common frameworks. And it's been one of the main reasons why the process of the development of frameworks has taken as long as it has, as we try to work out these issues.
Ariane Burgess.
Convener, there's one point that witnesses have just raised that's really important to farming in Scotland, from exactly the point that Rachel has just made.
Yeah, if we get a chance, we'll come back to you, Jim. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. So this is digging down a little bit more into divergence. So the Soil Association raised a number of concerns in their call for views and around the framework for organic production. It states that there is existing disagreement between parties on whether certain matters are devolved or reserved. And they point out that it's concerning that there is such a lack of clarity about what is devolved and what is reserved several years after the UK officially left the EU. So I'm just curious to learn from you in that kind of specific framework, what work is being done to generate that clarity. In particular, I think we have an ambition around organic production, and it would be useful to hear what's going on there.
No problem. I think it is really frustrating that we're still in that place, and I've had been liaising with the UK government over that, so we still remain in dispute over the exact responsibilities in relation to organics. But I don't think that hampers too much in terms of the work that we'd be looking to take forward through that framework. But yeah, George, I don't know if you want to comment on that.
A bit more detail. The difference of view between the administrations is principally around some of the import-export control elements of organics. Our view is that more of that is devolved than the UK government takes the view. But what the framework provides is a way through that, a sort of modus vivendi, if you like, for us, so that despite that disagreement, we can effectively park that and get on with it. And so it sets out a way of making sure that we can still recognise our organic certification bodies and all the other functions that need to be carried out, so that we can do that on a collaborative basis. So there is a disagreement, in the same way that in other areas we've had disagreements with the UK government on some of the fair dealing and supply chains provisions in the Agriculture Act on producer organisations. But we try to not let that get in the way of actually making progress.
So in terms of stakeholders who are working within that area, if we've parked an aspect, how do you communicate? How are you communicating to them that we're moving forward, it's okay?
So the guidance that's published on if you're needing to export or import or organic products, that will set out, okay, this is the body that you contact, so that there is no dubiety from the point of view of stakeholders or businesses, what they need to do. So we effectively, we've made sure that the outward communication to stakeholders takes account of the position that the accommodation we've reached as to how we're going to work.
Okay. I think where that may have had an impact, I'm sure you can correct me if I'm wrong in relation to that as well, is particularly in relation to notification of SIs, where I think we don't get notified if they believe that it's or the Parliament hasn't been notified in that regard. And I think that's where we have flagged that and raised that with the committee previously, and why we continue to raise that with the UK government. So I think that's where we see one of the main impacts of that.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Convener.
Jenny Mintel.
Thank you. We've heard from some stakeholders who have expressed a view that the common framework should underline minimum standards and commit to non-regression, and only some of the frameworks set these baseline standards. For example, the plant varieties and seeds framework set out an intention to maintain minimum standards across the UK, with opportunity for nations to flex above these standards where appropriate. So I'm interested to know why there are different approaches to the standards, and if would it not be better, an improvement, to set the baseline to have that consistently across the common frameworks?
Yeah, I think on the consistency point more broadly, I know that that's an issue that's been raised, and again, that's why we want to go through the scrutiny process and to reflect on any particular comments that come out in relation to that. Also, you talked about one of the frameworks there, I think that was in relation to plant health, but we also have the same in relation to animal health and welfare, where we've set the minimum of standards that we would expect to adhere to as a result of that. So if there are particular comments from the committee in relation to that, more than happy happy to consider it. But I think those ones in particular, I think where we're dealing with animal health, welfare, I think it makes sense for us to have that baseline and to start from there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Okay, we've heard about the interaction between the forthcoming agricultural bill and the Subsidy Control Act and how they may interact. Can you tell us whether there's any implications in the same regard with the Fisheries Framework and the Subsidy Control Act?
I'm not able to give a lot more detail on that at the moment because, again, these are one of the issues that we're working through. And I referred to earlier in relation to subsidy control and officials working together in relation to the guidance through that. That's also an area in relation to fisheries and aquaculture that we're working on at the moment as well. But I'd be happy to keep the committee updated on that.
Yeah, that would be useful. If there's anything comes up, if you could write to the committee on that, that would be helpful.
Can you?
Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much. With the what we were talking about earlier on in terms of the policy divergence, the EU policy allowed the Scottish Government to have LFAS. Do you see any concerns going forward with a similar type of policy being introduced to the Scottish Agricultural Support Bill within the UK Government's Internal Market Act or Subsidy Control Bill?
That was in the response that I'd provided earlier, and I was outlining some of the support that we give. It's LFAS that was actually in my mind when we were discussing that, and because again, that's support that we offer in Scotland that isn't offered elsewhere in the UK. And where we saw the real threat to that was from the Subsidy Control Act.
Yeah. Do you have a concern that potential for you to implement something like that is going to...
Yes, we still have that concern with the Subsidy Control Act because, again, there weren't any amendments made that had actually resolved any of the concerns that we'd raised in relation to it.
Okay, thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
The points that Jim Fairley is making, it might be useful, not maybe right now, but if the Cabinet Secretary could provide the committee with the powers that relate to following our exit from the EU that related solely to reserve matters but now relate to Scotland, so the new powers that will be conferred on Scotland relating to agriculture and the islands. It'd be interesting to have an understanding of which powers that were solely related to reserves matters now are relating to Scotland.
I'd be happy to set that out in the concerns. I'm not aware if the committee has been copied into all the correspondence that we've had with the UK government. I know that my colleague Ivan McKee was dealing with that with his UK government counterparts in relation to the Subsidy Control Bill, but I'd be happy to provide that information as well as that further evidence that we've provided.
Thank you.
Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. We've spoken a bit about the Scottish Government choosing to keep regulatory alignment with EU frameworks. I was just wondering if we could dig a bit into the reasoning why and, you know, what are the benefits of doing this?
We've made that policy decision and set that out right from the start, that we want to remain aligned with the EU, ultimately, for our reaccession as well. Mm-hmm. But we also want to maintain the minimum, the standards that have been set by the EU, but to go further than that if we can and if we feel that's appropriate as well. So we do think that's an important starting point, even in terms of facilitating trade. We've seen the problems that have emerged where there hasn't been that commitment in relation to maintaining that alignment. So that's certainly from our perspective where we're coming from in relation to that.
Thank you. Is there anything in particular that we should be aware of on this committee in regards to keeping that alignment with EU regulations within those frameworks? Is there anything at the moment that's a priority for us?
I'd be happy to come back to you with further information in relation to that and to keep the committee appraised, but I think that could well be, I don't know if that's an area for potential further monitoring and review when we look to the consideration of the frameworks in that regard. Sorry, George, I don't know if you want to come in.
Just to say the obvious example of that is the retained EU law bill, because as that is proposing on the face of it to sunset all of the retained EU law in this space, that's a considerable divergence from the EU position. Now, where the UK government, and the bill will end up remains to be seen. But you know, that's probably the biggest thing that's happening in the divergent space at the moment.
That's useful to know. Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
Supplementary on that question. The Scottish Government have the powers to adopt, amend and abandon retained EU law. Which of those would you scrap or retain with regards to the portfolio for islands and agriculture?
In relation to EU law?
Retained EU law.
That's part of the problem with the retained EU law bill, though, because there is so much of that that is relevant to particularly this portfolio, this committee and the NZET committee as well. I mean, to quantify that, no doubt you'll be aware of the Food Standards Scotland, the response that they had to the publication of that bill, because that would be a massive undertaking and exercise to go through if we had to replace retained EU law, because the timescale for that is the end of December next year. So,
what work has the government done on that? Because obviously there are laws that perhaps, you know, are not useful to agriculture and islands, or there may be laws that are, and the Scottish Government also have the ability to amend. But has there been any work done on which laws, EU retained laws, would be adopted, amended or abandoned?
I think some of that is actually set out in the framework, and I think in the animal health and welfare framework, when you look there, I think I'm sure you'll correct me if I'm wrong, it refers to about 500 pieces of legislation, of which 108 refer to animal health and welfare policy. So this isn't a small amount we're looking at here.
Maybe just to say that quite a bit of that work was actually done at the point that we did the deficiency fixing. Mm-hmm. So, for example, the Single Common Market Organisation regulations, part of Common Agricultural Policy, a behemoth of a regulation. At the point that we deficiency fixed that, there were some significant chunks of that on support for the sugar sector, on olive groves, that we simply deleted. That was by agreement between all the administrations. So we've already done quite a lot of the clearing out. That said, I have no doubt there are probably bits of old regulation that are still hanging about on the statute book that could be set to one side as a sort of sensible tidying up exercise. That is, of course, not what the retained EU law bill does. It basically takes everything off the statute book unless there is intervention.
Rachel, do you want to continue with your line of questioning?
Are you wanting me to ask my actual question?
Yes, please.
Okay. Thanks, convener. Well, yesterday was the third reading of the genetic technology bill at Westminster, and we know that how that could possibly support Scottish farmers with innovation and meeting net zero targets, improving food quality, and helping with the food supply issues that we have right now. I just wondered whether the Scottish Government would be taking an exclusion to the genetic technology bill.
Again, I mean, I would come back to, I know it's my colleague, Mary McCallan, who's been leading on that element of work as well, but I think, again, just highlight the frustration that this is one thing that jumped to the common frameworks process when it's the exact kind of issue that we should have been considering through it as well. So I know that it's going back through that process now in relation to the plant varieties and
technology
framework, I think, in relation to that too. But I'd be happy to come back with further information in relation to that.
Okay, Ewan, you mentioned earlier the exclusion that Scotland took on the single-use plastics. Could you relate to any examples within that process that might be relevant to the Rural Affairs and Islands portfolio with regards to taking a UK IMA?
Well, I think I'd defer to George on the policy detail.
Sorry,
okay. On that.
I think an important point to recognise is that Scotland cannot just take an exception. The powers to grant exception or exclusions from the Internal Market Act are conferred only on the Secretary of State. So we can simply seek to persuade the UK government to introduce an exception. In terms of market access and goods, the example on single-use plastic is so far, I think, the only exclusion that has been pursued. in some ways, well, that was more tricky because it was the first one through the process. In other ways, it was easier because actually all administrations were heading in pretty much the same direction to restrict single-use plastics, and the difference was more one of timescales in the different administrations. So in some ways, that was almost an easy one to deal with. I suspect that on precision breeding, where there is a greater policy divergence between the administrations, getting an exclusion is going to be a rather more of an uphill task.
And just on that, I mean, Scottish farmers don't want to be looking over the hedge to see English farmers with a competitive advantage. So do you, on these particular issues, have distinct conversations with farmers and those who will be affected by perhaps, let's use it in simplistic terms, taking an exclusion from the genetic technology bill?
I mean, we do have regular engagement with our stakeholders anyway, where issues such as that can be raised, and that would be the forum by which we discuss it in terms of the policy that we're seeking to take or to develop. I don't know if that answers your question.
It does. It's just that so many stakeholders have different views. I mean, we know that anyone that from the organic farming movement don't necessarily, you know, want the Scottish Government to take an exclusion on that particular bill. However, there are many others who are, I suppose, farmers dealing in traditional agricultural commodities who don't want to be looking over that hedge to see English farmers with a competitive advantage. So it was just, I wondered within this whole process, I don't know what the process is that you follow. Yes, there is stakeholder engagement, but you know, we hear so many different views here. How do you translate that into the policy that you create? And I know you're not leading on this. It's Mary McCallum.
Oh, but that's...
We don't focus necessarily specifically on the genetic modification bill, but the general approach you would have to look to get an exception and how you make your case for that. Can you also in your answer consider, so the single-use plastic, we've touched on that, it was a bit messy, didn't go particularly well. If you're looking for exceptions again, what lessons have you learned and what different approach would you take? So if you could put all that in your answer, if you like.
Yeah, no problem. And that's where I think I would just come back to what I'd said earlier as well about, you know, the common frameworks in itself won't address that problem because it's the mechanism that we deal that if we're taking a different position to the UK government, it's how we manage that divergence and what that might look like and the implications, how we consider the implications of that. It doesn't replace our normal process of policy development and engagement with stakeholders. You know, that's the issue that I have in the round, I think, across the portfolio. We deal with stakeholders with very different, sometimes very different polarised views, and then you have to listen to that. You know, that's obviously the responsibility of my role, and then determine which way forward or how you're going to take that policy forward. So the common frameworks itself do not replace that process. In relation to the exemptions and the process from that, again, it's important that we learn the lessons. As George was saying, that was the first time that we'd been through that process and really testing the water of that as well. I don't think that it was more, I think, from the UK government side, I think it would be fair to say, in terms of, I think, when they brought their regulations forward, the gap in implementation that we had in relation to that, and the fact that it was narrower in scope than what we'd had. But again, all we can do is learn the lessons as to how that example was taken through as we look to deal with similar issues as we go forward.
Okay, thank you. Alistair Allen, a supplementary.
Yeah, it was really just to ask on the single-use plastics issue that's been mentioned there, you know, about the lessons going forward for how you would deal with the UK government again if similar issues arose.
Oh, sorry, Ewan, I think we'll come in on that point.
Thanks, Cabsec. I suppose a couple of observations. It was the first outing for the exclusions process, so understandable if Processes take time to bed in. People understand what's being asked of them at different stages. The process itself, such as it is, and it is fairly straightforward, is appended to a written ministerial statement laid in the House of Commons in early 2021, which we can send the link of that to the committee if they don't have it. And it's simply about a ministerial commitment to use the delegated powers of the Act to give an exclusion where that's been where policy agreement and policy divergence has been reached in a framework, and then how that works, which is just around the exclusion seeking party using the framework structures to notify. The challenges raised, the lessons to be learnt, I think, were around just being all parties being clear about decision points, what has been agreed at a particular point, about minimising the scope for reopening issues where agreement has been reached, and giving effect to an exclusion in a timely manner. So that's probably the three broad pieces of learning that we'll be looking at applying to future exclusions processes.
Thank you.
That's useful. Just in practicality, when an exemption is suggested or requested, at what point do all the devolved nations get involved? Is that from the outset? So if there's a request... For example, single-use plastics. Do the Welsh and Northern Ireland assemblies get involved in that discussion or negotiation from the outset, or only when there's a potential issue as part of the framework?
I think the general purpose of the frameworks is that we deal with these issues at as low a tier in the structure as possible. So an issue like that, say it was in the agriculture space, the policy collaboration group that I've mentioned a couple of times would be the obvious place, official to official, for that to be raised. And that would probably be at the initial stages, one administration saying, oh, they're planning to pursue a policy in this area, they foresee the need that might require an Internal Market Act exemption. Mm-hmm. So there would be sort of advance notice given to the other administrations. The work would then be probably in that same group. Whichever administration is proposing it is the one that has to set out the details of what would be being looked for. That would go through, as I say, in the agriculture space, the policy collaboration group, equivalent groups in other policy areas, and to the interministerial group. And essentially that's the process that was followed in relation to single-use plastics. As Ewan said, there have been some bumps along the way. At one stage, there was something that we thought had been agreed between the administrations, sort of at official level, and then at an interministerial group, it seemed that wasn't quite the case. Nevertheless, we've managed to work through that. I suppose the other lesson, just to throw in quickly, is that the lesson is that we were right, that seeking broader exemptions is probably, we would say, the better way forward, because otherwise the UK government and Parliament and this committee as well is probably going to get a series of narrow exemptions as, if DEFRA chooses to take a slightly wider approach to single-use plastic or the Welsh Government, we potentially get a series of incremental instruments having to be made, rather than actually accept at the outset, actually we're all heading in roughly the same direction in this space, we should take a broad exception so that we don't have to get into the debate every single time. But we'll see how we get on.
Yeah. Okay, so just to get it clear in my head, so the practical way to do this would be through the policy collaboration group, which has civil servants from the four nations, and then the senior official programme board, once again, which has representation from the four nations to scrutinise it and look at any potential issues. And then that would go to the inter-ministerial group, where potentially a final decision is agreed. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Sorry, Ewan.
Just very quickly, your original question, I think, was probing the idea, would the initial engagement be bilateral between the a DA and UKG. Frameworks are, the default is that these are multilateral fora for engagement, and actually the single-use plastics example means that you're gleaning useful information from Welsh Government and its own parallel plans, as George said, we're moving in the same space. But just to emphasise that it's also, that process also applies to UK Government, should it wish to seek an exclusion for a devolved policy affecting only England. It's not a one-way street with the devolved governments seeking an exclusion from UKG.
That's hugely helpful to have a practical idea of how we go through the process. Thank you for that, that's useful. Rachel Hamilton.
No, I've... Well, do you want me to ask the next one?
Yes,
we're
please.
On the next Okay, so it's really about how future trade agreements will interact with the common frameworks within the remit that you have as Cabinet Secretary.
Well, that's the thing. It's set out in some of the frameworks as well, recognising how that could be dealt with, and it refers to within that about the trade-specific engagement fora that there are as well. So, again, I don't know if it would be helpful to have an illustrative example. Obviously, we've been through the process with some free trade agreements. So I'll hand over to George, who can give a bit more detail on that.
Okay, so again, looking at the agriculture space, as well as the group set out in this framework, there's a group called the Trade Engagement Group that has been running for several years, and that again is all four administrations working together. At various points, that's been looking at themes, for instance, what would we want to seek in trade agreements on, provisions on sanitary, phytosanitary, antimicrobial resistance and the like. So that's discussion between DEFRA and the other administrations. Ultimately, of course, trade agreements are being pursued by other parts of the UK government. The devolved administrations don't have a direct involvement in that. So at most, we are sort of advisory into that process. And then once a trade agreement is agreed, it becomes an international obligation. And then we and the other administrations are obliged to observe and implement it, which in some cases might require legislative amendments. So then you get into the process of, those legislative amendments would have to be considered and agreed through the framework process between the administrations.
Were there legislative amendments that had to be considered to export lamb to the US, for example?
Not on this side of the Atlantic. It required changes in the United States to their legislation. Of course, that was not in pursuit of a sort of full trade agreement. That was simply a sort of bilateral agreement on that very specific subject.
I'm interested in the trade engagement group. Who represents Scotland within that sphere? Is it civil servants?
It's civil servants, yes. I think for a large part of the last several years, it's been me. I'm also the representative on the Policy Collaboration Group, the Senior Officials Programme Board, and a regular attender alongside the Cabinet Secretary at the Interministerial Group. So,
and my other question on that group is that you define the difference between trade agreements in the UK to the trade agreement group and the different scope of the work within that group. Mm-hmm. What kind of discussions do you have within that trade agreement group about agriculture and fisheries? I mean, what scope do you have?
It has been principally looking at, as I mentioned, the sanitary and phytosanitary provisions that commonly occur within trade agreements. And some of the detail of that, the very specific groups on animal health and plant health. So we defer to the experts on those particular topics. One area that we've not been able to engage with in the trade engagement group has been on some of the market access and the tariffs, which probably for us is actually, you know, as significant, if not a more significant issue. But that is something that has been, you know, very jealously guarded by the Department for International Trade. So our engagement and trade engagement group is with DEFRA in the main. There is also some work now. There's an environment group that has been set up that I think will pick up some of the environmental aspects of trade agreements.
Okay, thank you.
We're going to move on to question 12, Jenny Minto.
Some of the evidence that we gathered specifically from the Soil Association Scotland talked about a group, the EU Civil Dialogue Group, which was used to pull together evidence from stakeholders, whether it's producers specifically involved in organic production. So, and they've commented that this group is missing from the structure of the common frameworks. So I'm interested to know, and you talked about routes of engagement, Cabinet Secretary, how the Scottish Government or perhaps how this committee can ensure that the stakeholders, I think we've touched on it a bit earlier, but how the stakeholders mm-hmm. can be engaged in the process.
Yeah, again, that's one point that I've taken strongly from the evidence that the committee's heard, as well as from the House of Lords evidence as well. And I know that broadly everybody thinks that there should be a greater opportunity for that within the frameworks. Again, I'm more than happy to consider any particular suggestions that the committee would have in that regard in relation to stakeholder engagement. But also, coming back to what the point that I'd made earlier about, you know, we still need to be able to ensure that we can have that free and frank discussion with other administrations within the UK, and also that this is not replacing the normal stakeholder engagement that we have. But again, more than happy to hear any particular comments from the committee.
I suppose we've got to ensure that there's enough time built into the timetable to allow that scrutiny and engagement to happen.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Just briefly, on that, you, I think, touched on the EU Civil Dialogue Group and how it's the previous setup under the EU gave certain stakeholders, particularly in the case I think alluded to, organic stakeholders, a voice. Are there any other groups that we need to reinvent to try and ensure that stakeholders are involved in the way that they were when we were still a member of the European Union, or is that? That's not meant as a trick question, but just curious to know if there are other things we need to reinvent apart from our reputation in the world.
I think probably in relation to, I mean, obviously with leaving the EU, we've lost access to a number of groups and forums that we would have been part of previously. And I think when I'd given evidence to the committee before, in relation to the Joint Fisheries Statement, that was one thing that we highlighted. And I think when you look at our Marine Scotland Science, which is a leader in Europe in relation to the work that it undertakes in the marine labs, but there's no doubt that, you know, we suffer now from not having the same links as what we had before and not having this the same access. In relation to stakeholders, I would come back to the same point that I'd made previously. It doesn't change how we develop policy, because we would still be engaging with stakeholders in the normal way. But I think another example in relation to some of the loss of access that we previously would have had with the EU that we don't have now is through the European Food Safety Authority as well, and the implications that's had for us. And that's meant that we've had to put an entirely new process into place in GB that involves the Food Standards Agency, Food Standards Scotland, and it's also added extra complexity and complications for businesses to adhere to different processes as well. But I think those are probably the few examples that I'd use, if that's helpful.
Thank you, Convener.
We're going to move on to the loss of capacity from EU scientific agencies. The next question, I don't know whether the vast majority of that question has been asked, but Karen, you may have supplemented on that.
Thank you. Commissioner, because we have lost that access to the EU scientific agencies, what does that look like for the working groups and for them gaining access to that scientific advice? What can we start looking to do now, and what was really the fallout of that?
I think, well, the previous example that I'd highlighted there, that's meant that, you know, for example, it's the Food Standards Agency and Food Standards Scotland. They've had to be involved in that new process. That's one specific example. I don't know if officials have any more at the moment that it would be useful to highlight, but I'd be happy to follow that up with committee and provide more detail as to some of the wider implications of that and losing that access.
I think EPSA is perhaps the best example. We haven't lost access completely. So if a novel food goes to EFSA for risk assessment and consideration, we would still see the output from that process. And so that can be used by FSA, FSS, when they do, assuming that there's a similar application to in GB, that they can use that, although they can't simply say, OK, Europe has done it, therefore we will just automatically do the same thing. I suppose the loss there is more, you see the output at the end of the process, you don't see what's gone on within the EFSA process along the way. So we're rather blind to developments on the European stage. So another example of that, perhaps one of the very influential groups is SCOPAF, the Standing Committee on Plants, Animal, Food and Feed. And that is determining maximum residue levels and the likes in products. So that's quite significant for Scotland. We no longer are obviously part of that. We know that they're working on some topics at the moment that could be of significant impact on Scottish industry, but we're not party to the detail of what's going on. Essentially, we're restricted to what can be seen in the public domain.
Thank you.
Thank you. Jenny Minto.
Quickly, I'm interested to know how the newly established Environment Standards Scotland will be able to scrutinise decision-making within the common frameworks, processes or feed-in with their development ideas?
I suppose I would just start off by saying that the role of ESS is to assess the compliance with environmental law, and I think the frameworks in and of themselves don't alter that or the role of public bodies that would be engaged with that as well. I think obviously as we're potentially looking to if there were any legislative changes that were due to be made, I imagine they would have an interest in that. But I think in relation to the frameworks themselves, I don't know how much of a role that they would be expected to have or the input that they would expect to have.
Okay.
In that.
Thank you.
I'm just very conscious of the time. Can you allow us another two questions?
Yeah, that's fine.
That would be much appreciated. Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much, Convener. How does the Scottish Parliament get informed about decisions on where an exemption to the UK Internal Market Act has been sought? I wonder if you could tell us how you get told and how we get told.
Yeah, I know that about probably more about the... I think I've mentioned previously in terms of how we inform the committees of some of the work that's undertaken in relation to the interministerial group. For example, we have the communiques. We also send over a note of some of the items that have been discussed. In relation to the exclusions process in particular, obviously that would have taken part through the NZ committee. I think the Parliament is notified at the point at which the secondary legislation goes through, but in terms of the earlier engagement in that, I don't know if officials would have any more information as to if there had been any prior engagement with the committee previous to that, given that's the only example that I have.
No, I think the Cabinet Secretary is right that the record of it would effectively be in the communiques from the interministerial group. Once regulations are actually coming forward, then there is a process that's in place, because the Scottish ministers, their consent is generally required to those, and there is agreement with the Parliament on the process involving committees before ministers are able to signal that consent. So there is at that stage a formal process. I suppose the gap at the moment, it would be if an exception has been sought by one administration but not agreed to, that would obviously not go through that process. But I would expect that if we were in that situation, that might become a fairly significant feature in the notes from interministerial groups.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
I don't have any more questions. Oh, yes, I do. Yep. So what information would be provided to the Parliament to enable it to monitor the functioning of the frameworks themselves and be able to input into review and further development of the frameworks?
In relation to the role of the Parliament in monitoring and reviewing the frameworks, I think that's really important as part of the process. We've, between the different governments, we've been discussing as to how that might look. But again, that's a point that I'm keen to hear from the committee as to what you think that scrutiny can or what it should look like in relation to that role. So open to consideration of that if there's ways that you think it can be improved beyond what's set out in the frameworks as they are at the moment.
Okay.
Thank you.
I think Ewan wanted to come in on that one.
Very quickly, just this programme of parliamentary engagement with the four UK legislatures is an essential part of the finalisation of frameworks, and there's already been some good work done by the House of Lords Committee and elsewhere on these questions around future reporting. And Mr Allen in particular will know from the work that the Constitution Committee is undertaking and looking in the round at how the Parliament fulfils its scrutiny function in a very changed environment, and frameworks, Internal Market, Continuity Act, you know, the boundaries are blurred between lots of these considerations. So we're engaging directly with the officials on that, the Constitution Committee as well, on some of these questions around future reporting and notification.
Thank you. The committee certainly has had concerns relating to the detail that accompanies SIs and legislation that we have got to look at, timescales and whatever. And I know that it will form part of our discussions on our work programme going forward to see how we address that. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I think the impression I get overall is that there's a sense of that common frameworks are a positive way. It's about collaboration through agreement rather than imposition. I'm just curious to hear, could a common framework be created in the future where currently the areas are reserved or legislated for by Westminster and therefore strengthening devolution instead?
As I've said in relation to the, and as you've set out there, I do think it's a really positive model that I think we could see potentially, or you would like to think it could be used more widely in terms of how we can engage in some of these issues. But yeah, sorry, George, you want to go in?
One example in that space, and I don't think we would count it as a formal framework, the frameworks had a very specific purpose, but is in relation to protected geographical indications for foods. Now, that is, we accept a reserve matter. Nevertheless, we managed to agree with the UK government and the other administrations a process whereby all of those administrations are involved in the consideration of any proposals that come forward from any part of GB. So that there is an area where, you know, ultimately the decisions are still for the Secretary of State, but there is rather more formal involvement in that process than hitherto.
So not specifically a new common framework, but that there are areas of agreed collaboration that seems that's coming forward more. Sorry, thank you.
I mean, common frameworks, their genesis was in a very specific purpose to consider the management of policy divergence in areas of devolved competence that intersect with EU law when we were an EU member state. And the Cabinet Secretary is absolutely right. The value here is recognising the benefits that accrue from taking a frameworks approach to other areas, including reserve matters that impact differently or more significantly in Scotland, and seeing them as mechanisms to the founding in cooperation rather than you know, just put more grit in the system. It is to everyone's benefit and makes for better policy.
Thank you.
That's probably a positive note to end on. I know at the moment the common frameworks have been put together, and it's a firefighting approach really to ensure we get legislation in place. But from what you said, it would appear that in the future common frameworks could indeed be a way to promote devolved priorities.
It's about that collaboration on the basis that we're working together as equals. So I think it is a really positive way of working. So providing that everybody adheres to that process, then I think it can be a really positive way forward.
Thank you, Mary. On that note, absolutely. Thank you very much today. It's a very cluttered and complicated topic, but your answers have certainly helped us today. Thank you very much. I'm not going to suspend the meeting. We're going to continue because we've only got one other item of business in public, which is the consideration of a consent notification relating to UKSI, the Animals and Animal Health, Feed and Food Plants and Plant Health Amendment Regulation 2022, and I refer members to paper 3 on page 27. Also draw members' attention to the Minister for the Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity's letter, which was sent on the 31st of October. This letter indicates that the provision that amended Article 18 of the Plant Health Regulation has been removed from the SI and will be incorporated in a different SI, which will be notified to the Parliament later in November. Do any members have any comments on the notification? Are members content with the Scottish Government's decision to consent to the provision set out in the notification being included in the UK rather than Scottish subordinate legislation? Agreed. Thank you. That concludes our business in public and we'll now move into private session.